There's only pleasure for a season in these things, but the retribution of living a life such as this is detrimental, not only to yourself, but think of your children. I mean, what are we teaching our children? When I look back on my past folly, I think to myself, what are my children thinking? What kind of substance, what kind of truth, what kind of truth is in that type of life? And I seen that I was actually being a hindrance to them and actually validating their behavior and justifying it by showing them the wrong way. Well, I thank God that by Jesus Christ, I'm in the right way. And now he can show me and teach me by redeeming the time and working on my salvation with fear and trouble. And I thank him. I do not take it for granted.
Not drink beer or smoke. I want to thank God for gaming. Mom that does not go out dancing, but a mom that stays home with her children.
I thank God for my salvation. I appreciate the Lord for these opportunities to come out and share what God has done for me. You know, I grew up in a church home, preacher's kid, and I seen the world as all fun. That's how I saw it. I saw it as all fun. And I realized, I said, you know, when I was younger, that I want to go have that fun, and I want to get saved right before I die. That's how I'm going to do it. I want to have all my fun, and right before I die, I want to get saved. But, you know, the whole time I was just going back over my life, and I was just thinking how I never calculated or thought about, you know, the devil in that equation. You know, you're going to have this fun, but I didn't realize that I was going to have to pay for all this fun I was going to have, you know. And I didn't realize that the devil was going to take my life and make it miserable. And then after my life was miserable, he was going to make me feel like I wasn't worth nothing, that I was beyond God's help, that I was helpless, I was hopeless. He's got all those kind of things most people don't even think about, nor do they consider when they consider how much fun they're going to have. And in the end, you're going to have to pay for every bit of it. But I thank God that he had mercy on me, gave me another opportunity. I thank God I'm in my right mind, how he cleaned me up. I thank God for how the things that I gave myself to has been replaced with a strong despise for anything that's not of God. You know, I just thank God that he just really helped me to see, even when he saved me, the kind of person that I was. He really had to expose sin for what it was. He really had to show me that I can play. I remember one time I was in prison. I was that did like 16 years in prison altogether. For all the little fun I had, I did 16 years behind bars. And I remember one day I looked in the mirror and I had to tell myself, Frank, you lost in the game, man. You know, you thought you had it going on. You did this. You thought you were slick and all these kind of things, but you lost in the game. And you know what? That was about the best time of my life. I was so glad I lost. I said, nah, I ain't got to even go back to it. I lost in the game. I accept that. I thank God that I'm a winner. I'm on the winning side right now. I thank God for all he's done for me, how he delivered me, gave me a right mind, and I'm about the things of God. And I appreciate God, and I thank God for my salvation.
This dark world. And I was thinking, I'll live for Christ. And before I got saved, I was living for the devil. And I was thinking, you're living for somebody. Okay? You're either living for Christ or you're going to live for the devil. But I want to thank God, once you get a genuine dose of salvation, he cleans your life up. Okay? There are things in sin that we're ashamed of. The devil, he'll take you further than what you would ever want to go before. And I was just thinking how, before I got saved, I thought I was living, okay, because I was doing the things that I thought was right, because everybody around me was doing these things. You got boyfriends, you got girlfriends, you smoke, you drink, you club, this, that, and the other. And we were just going the way of the world, okay? But one day, God arrested my soul. Okay, and before I got saved, I was searching. You know, I would go to different churches to find the truth because that's what I wanted. And when I went to different churches, I would look at the people, I would hear the word, and I would think, they are doing the same thing that I'm doing, but they're just going to church. The way they dress, their conversation, some had boyfriends, some had girlfriends, some shacked, living together, not being married. But I want to thank God how he changed my life 20 years ago. And sometimes I am in awe at the change that God made in my life. You don't have to worry about, you know, what your man is doing or who he's, you know, with or whatever. When you get a true, genuine dose of salvation, that takes the wings of the morning. God will put you in your right mind, okay? And if you're a parent, you have children, He will teach you how to be a father. He will teach you how to be a mother. When I got saved, I had two small children, and I was expecting my third child, okay? And then when I got saved, I was at home with the children, okay? Because I was, you know, God took me from one location to another location, but he taught me how to be a mother, how to act right, how to dress right, how to talk to my children, not to have men coming in and out of the home or, you know, painting your face up with makeup and, you know, going to the clubs and, you know, he taught me how to be at home. And I want to thank God how he even blessed me even further, you know, and it's like, God, you can't lose with God. All you can do is win. Of course, we do things that we're ashamed of, and we're going to have to, you know, reap those things. But when you have God on your side, it takes the sting out of it. He'll, you know, make you be able to go through it right. But when you don't have God in your life, you're pulling for straws. You're trying to find help in, out of this person or out of that person. But God is able to clean your life completely up. He will change your mind. The way you're thinking now, you're not going to think that way once you get a true dose of salvation. I thank God, and we're here because we love you. We want you to experience what we have, okay? Because 20 years ago, you couldn't tell me I'm going to be living like this. But this is a blessed life. It is a pure life. It is a holy life, a clean life, a life that you don't have to be ashamed of what you did last night or who you slept with last night or what you stole last night. You don't have to be ashamed of this life, and I want to thank God for his goodness.
Amen. Anyone else?
And it was only when I decided to let God in that things started making sense. It's hard because my family is not where I'm at, but I just want to thank everybody who spoke today and this Willis family. Because Kamara, you never gave up on me. You always saw the beauty in me when I never saw it in myself. So I want to thank God for this beautiful family, this Willis family, and for being here today. So thank you so much, everybody. Thank you to that little girl. Thank you.
I came to the Lord for relief when burdened with guilt and with sin. He cleansed me and gave me his peace, the Spirit to witness within. Oh, how happy am I, happy am I. Savior so nice, Savior so nice. I have found sweet rest on Jesus.
No many the troubles I meet,
you keep me and help me along. I'll sit at his glorified feet, for he is my joy and my song. Oh, how happy am I, happy am I. Glory and praise to thy name, for what thou didst suffer for me. Oh, for saving my soul when I came and gave myself up unto thee. All glory and praise to thy name, for what thou didst suffer for me. For saving my soul when I came and gave myself up unto thee. In Jesus I found a sweet rest, from sorrow, from toil, and from care. In him I am happy and blessed, for he all my burdens doth bear. Oh, how happy am I, happy am I, Savior.
about how the beautiful benefits of sunlight and how it's not just the sisters make the day beautiful. It actually has nutrients in that sunlight. You get that vitamin D, and you know, you get, it can maybe make you your mood better, you sleep better, but it's nothing like the light of God. It's nothing like it. I was thinking about the day I got saved and he shone that light down in my soul. The day might not have been right, but he made that day right. And that light doesn't go away. This sunlight, when it gets to fall in the wintertime, you can be right back in the, you know, those cold months, and it's going to be kind of dreary. But God's light doesn't change. You can always keep that light. As long as you're living for him, you can keep that light in your soul. It's going to protect you. It's going to guide you. You don't have to be happy walking around with sin. You can have a smile on your face because it's genuine. It don't have to be fake. It don't have to be because I got a man or I got a woman or I got money in my pocket. You might not have any money at the time. But the light of God is so precious. And I'm just thanking God that I can continue to walk in this light. And if you're looking for that light, you're looking for a change in your life, this is where it's at. I'd like to thank God for being here tonight, to be able to be a witness before you. Now I'm thinking in this world, who do you know? You can look at your friends, your family, and ask yourself, who do you know that will forgive you when you are unforgivable? Who do you know that will redeem you when you are unredeemable? When you've reached the lowest point of your life, when you've gone as far as you can go in sin, who will be there to help you, to inspire you, to let you know there's a better way for you? Well, I know a man, and that man came into my life one day, and he let me know that despite the condition that I was in, despite all the sins I had done before him, he was willing to forgive me if I met the conditions, which was to turn away from sin and say to him, Lord, I'll never do this again. If you help me get out of this horrible pit, I will turn from this and I will allow you to come into my life and give me strength and give me hope and guide me through this life where I can glorify you in everything that I do. I was thinking how in the Bible, there were the scribes and the Pharisees. They were religious people of that time. And they looked down on Jesus because he spent so much time among the sinners. And they even said, you know, why is he dining with those folks? Those folks that are lost and condemned and not living right. Well, those are the folks that he died for. Those were such were some of us. And we thank God so much that he didn't judge us like natural man might judge us and make you feel like there is no hope for you. Thank God he looked beyond your sins. He'll look beyond all that you've done. I don't care how far you feel you've gone in sin and you feel like there is just no hope for me. That's not true. There's always hope in Christ. If you just come to him and just surrender to him, he will turn your life around. He will give you joy unspeakable. He'll give you peace in your soul. I was thinking about how many times in sin I had drugged my children up and down the East Coast and moved here, stayed here for about a year, and moved somewhere else. I think me and my youngest son were counting how many times I had moved in my lifetime. I had got to 38, and I just said, okay, that's enough. That's enough. Don't talk about that anymore. I was just restless. My soul, I kept feeling like if I went to a new place, I'd get a new start. But I was still there wherever I went. My sinful self was still there. And it wasn't until I yielded my heart to God and surrendered to his will that he took my life, he picked me up, he turned me around, he saved my children. I'm so grateful for all that he's done. If you had looked at me maybe 10 years ago, you would have looked and said, she's on the scrap heap. There's no hope for her. But I thank God that today I can say there is hope. And I'm so encouraged tonight. If you're at a place in your life where you're tired and you're tired of trying to figure out this life yourself, I welcome you to come on and give Christ a try. He will not fail you. He will help you and he will guide you. So please open your hearts to us tonight. We're out here because we love you and we have the answer. That's why we're here. for you who are out there seeking and this thing and that thing, we have the answer, and that is Jesus Christ alone.
Wow, this sun is really...
I want to thank God for my salvation. Thank God for being saved today. It's been 2 months since I've been saved, and I've been walking right with God. And I was talking to somebody at my job yesterday, was telling them just about how God had mercy on me. And I'm kind of nervous. But I was just telling them, like, I don't know why. I asked him, and obviously he didn't have the answer, but I said, why did God have mercy on me after I turned my back? Like, he didn't have to do it. But I thank God that I'm saved. You know what I mean? I'm happy. I got something in my soul. That song said, I found sweet rest. And I'm thinking about, man, I didn't have everything even when I was in sin. But if you do got everything in sin, you still not happy. And I just dare you to just come, just taste salvation, just walk all the way right with God, and he going to lead you all the way. I just thank God for my salvation. I thank God for being here. And I think about a song that the pastor sung before, and in one of the verses he said he'll do the same for you. The same thing he did for me, he'll do it for you. He's not a respecter of persons. He'll have mercy on whom he will have mercy. So I dare you, just come try it and just give your life to God. I promise you'll never regret it.
Tonight, I wanted to get up, and I thought, well, I'll wait a while. But I don't want to let this night pass without giving God thanks and praise for saving me. They sung a song earlier about joy, and my mind went back years ago, how I was down so low. And the pastor told me one day, he said, Dorinda, he said, God has done some for you, girl. I said, yeah, I know. He said, Dorinda, God has done something for you. I said, yeah, I know. But he wasn't happy with that. He said, girl, God has done something for you. I said, yes, I know. He said, girl, you ought to shout. I said, I do, you just don't see me. Now, I believe in being seen sometime and shouting for the Lord, but I'm so glad that God saved me and gave me an experience that I can have joy whether I'm in a crowd or whether I'm alone. Sometimes when I'm at home, I actually shout when I'm alone because I get to thinking of the good things that God has done for me. And I realize the devil has one purpose for everyone on this earth, and that is to steal from you, to kill you, and to totally destroy you. And he wanted to do that to me. And when I look at all the ways that the enemy came to steal from me, to destroy me, to kill me, my influence and everything, he wanted me to be able to never be useful again. But when I realize how God has turned things around, if you trust in God, you know you may have to reap some things, but you just hold on to God. God's gonna turn your tears into joy. He's gonna turn everything around.
He is that kind of God, and the joy of the Lord is our strength. And I'm so glad tonight that I'm saved. I'm glad I stuck it out with God. I'm glad I held on. Tonight, I feel like going on with God. It's a better life. It's a better way. And I'm thankful to be here tonight.
Freedom, wonderful freedom. I thank God that I've been saved and everything, and I enjoy these, and I can't wait until Friday night. With some of the sisters up here about their children. With women that have children, you can protect them to be saved with God. And when you're in sin, you can't protect them and teach them the right way. The right way to go. Instead of getting themselves in trouble, you can deal with it. And not with women, with men having guys come in and out and trusting these men. They can do something to your daughters or even your sons. This way, you can, women can be home with their children, their younger children, and don't have to worry about that. If they want to, they should, even dads can have a woman in the house and not worry about them doing something to their kids or anything like that. When they are saved, God will, especially with men, they can have a woman that they can trust. Even women that have younger children, God will lead them to a trusted man. So they don't have to worry about that at all. God can do that for you. In sin, you cannot do that. You have all these worries about having a job and everything. Just pray to God. When you get saved, God can provide that for you. And you don't have to. When you're in a jam, you can pray to God, and God can help you.
We're going to look into the Bible tonight. We're going to share a story of Christ, a story that Christ shared with the world. And it's often referred to as a story called The Rich Man and Lazarus. We're going to look at the story, The Rich Man and Lazarus. These are the end times, so we're going to let Christ preach. The Spirit of Christ preached through Noah, and we're going to allow a message that Christ gave to be shared with our community tonight. Luke chapter 16, verse 19. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for your goodness and faithfulness. We need you in a special way. Time is drawing to an end, and we ask you, dear God, that you would bless the word shared tonight. May souls, dear God, take heed and be inspired and encouraged, dear God. Father, we don't want to be like the rich man, dear God. Father, we want to be like Lazarus. Father, to help us to take heed to our never dying soul. Tonight may be the last opportunity for us to get right with God. Anoint your word in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, you can begin reading at verse Luke chapter 16, verse 19. This is a story that Jesus Christ shared with the world. Come on, read. This is a message that Jesus preached about the rich man and Lazarus. Come on and read.
There was a certain rich man.
There was a certain rich man.
Which was clothed in purple and fine linen.
Now, mind you, the world is coming to an end. We are right at the end of time. And Jesus gave prophecy, and he said certain things would take place. I can't tell you right before I come back, but certain things would take place right before I return. And since the year 2000, there have been a multitude of things that needed to take place, taking place. So Jesus said, it will be as the days of Noah, as the days of Sodom and Gomorrah. So he said, do the work of Noah so you can fulfill the burden I have. I was burdened because it's not my will that any should perish. Right before Noah, amen, came, I wanted to spare the world, but as important as that was, I said, Noah, spend some of your time building the ark. As important as that is, spend some of your time preaching the word so souls can make it in before it's too late. So God has commissioned his prophets, commissioned his true ministry, prepare the bride to meet Christ. Make sure everything is in order to meet Christ. Some may not be able to make it, my God, but also reach out to the lost and dying world that hopefully somebody get in right before the ark door closes. So there's a twofold message. Get the ark prepared so it can, my God, be prepared for the second coming of Christ and reach out to the lost and dying world. So here he said there was a certain man, a certain rich man,
which was clothed in purple and fine.
Now, this is not a parable. Some people that don't believe in hell will say this is a parable. Well, no parable does God use proper names. He'll say this, that, or the other. Here, he said there was a certain rich man, come on,
which was clothed in purple and fine linen.
Come on.
And fared sumptuously every day.
Yes.
And there was a certain beggar.
Hold on one moment. It says there was a certain rich man who was clothed in purple and fine linen. That purple denoted historically that he was related to royalty somewhere.
Right.
All right? And he fared sumptuously every day, lived a lavish lifestyle. Now, mind you, the Bible doesn't really say what deep sins he was involved in. Let me know a point here that it doesn't matter what you involve yourself in. That's not necessarily what's going to send you to hell. What's going to send many people to hell is what you didn't do. It doesn't say he got right with God. Now, you might not have done this or you might not have done that, but if you don't get right with God, you will be unprepared. Get that note here. It doesn't say he went, smoked crack cocaine, stuck up this, that, and the other. It's not just people. Hell will be filled with people that did wrong, but some of the people necessarily might not have a resume of just gross wickedness, but what sent them to hell is what they didn't do. You may say, what about if I didn't have a chance to get saved? The Bible says the grace of God that has bringing salvation has appeared to all men. Did not. So you let you know that the grace of God will reach out to your soul. The Bible says this is a light that lighteth every man that come into the world. You will not be an excuse in the judgment. Say, God, I didn't know. God will deal with you one-on-one if he has to. So here it shows the rich man, he just never got right with God. Come on and read.
And there was a certain beggar named Lazarus.
And there was a certain beggar named Lazarus.
Which was laid at his gate, full of sores.
Come on, laid at his gate, full of sores. This, come on.
And desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table.
Desiring to be fed with the crumbs from the rich man's table.
Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores.
Well, this right here gives you the evidence that he didn't have a regenerated heart, the rich man, because he didn't have any mercy. A regenerated heart will have mercy. A regenerated heart cares about people. A regenerated heart, my God, is not trying to dog people out. A regenerated heart is always about redemption. Always about what can I do to help it out? What can I do to figure it out? How can we get over this? A regenerated, when a heart, person's heart is right with God, they're always looking for a way to help out. How can I help the situation? Not like a woman that had the baby and it wasn't really her baby. She said, cut the baby in half.
the woman whose baby it really was said, hold on, let me go ahead and take it, baby. How can we have peace? How can we work this thing out? I'm not looking for destruction. I'm not looking to destroy somebody. I'm looking at how in the world can we figure this thing out? So here it shows, my God, it didn't say he didn't get saved, but it showed his heart wasn't really right with God. When a person's heart is right with God, they care about other folks.
That's right.
So here we got, my God, an individual, amen. Here we got people, my God, that concerned just about themselves. Some people very religious, concerned about themselves. But here, my God, he said, these folks care. The rich man didn't care about him. But thank God, God will have a people that care about folks. We could be at a nice little church building down on 140 West South Street tonight, but the saints came out and sat on this hot sun because we burned for souls, because we care about people. There was a group of people one time, they charged money for pews. It was a church denomination that said, what actually grew up out of that was the Free Methodist. They said, we're not going to charge money for pews anymore. My God, but God has a people, amen. The Bible says, free to give, free to receive. Give the gospel out, my God. Amen. So here, these individuals didn't have a regenerated heart because it was malicious. They were after destruction, not after redemption. Come on, read. And it came to pass. Come on.
And was carried by the angels into Abraham's bosom.
Hold on. And it came to pass that this beggar died and was carried into his bosom. Come on.
By the angels into Abraham's
bosom. And was carried by the angels into Abraham's bosom. Come on.
The rich man also died.
Come on.
And was buried.
So it shows he had a proper burial. He was wealthy. But it's amazing when you get to heaven, all how much money you had, how many degrees you had, all that foolishness ain't going to matter. The beggar didn't have a proper burial, but he had a proper, my God, resurrection. Yeah. My, my, my. So don't get caught up about what outfit you got on, what type of casket. Just worry about your resurrection, my God. Just worry about you being right so the angels can come and get. Don't curse something about the way your hair is done. Give me a gold casket with this trim. Listen, hey, I just want to be saved, right, man, when he called my number. I just want to be right with God. I may be broke. You may have to take it off. My God, you're sitting there in the bed. I was talking to my wife the other night. I said, I'm probably sitting in the bed like this, breathing. You give me a little water in the straw, seeing if I'm still. My God, I'm at the end. You're going to look over that way and look back. I'm gone. My Lord, y'all may not see him, my God, but if my heart is right, there's going to be some angels in the room. Listen, I believe, amen. Holy Ghost is faithful. Why? Because the Bible said, yea, though I walk through the valley of death. Listen to me. At the end time, there's a fight that goes on. The battle of the shadow of death. The devil try to bring up all stuff you did in your past. Anything you might not have went through quick. He gonna try to put all stuff up. He gonna try to get you to doubt. To just to doubt your assurance of your salvation. To doubt that Jesus was. He may pull up Muhammad or Buddha or something you did 40 years ago or some trial you might not have went through absolutely right that you got right about. He gonna try to bring all this stuff up. But don't you know God is the I know this is about the rich man and Lazarus, my God, but this is about sex making an end. My Lord, we need some encouragement sometimes. Amen. Come on, amen.
The rich man also died.
Yes. Folk in the streets, somebody crazy. For what they doing? For out there shouting and rejoicing. Y'all supposed to be pleading with us. Tell us what we doing wrong to get right. We're trying to encourage you to get right.
Difference. But here,
closed now.
My Lord, my Lord.
The door of mercy is closed now, sir. Father, please tell me. I'm sorry, God. I'll live for you. I don't want to be down here no more. I'm tired. I'll live for you. Son, I believe it. I believe it. But it's too late. It's too late now. When the door of mercy closed, it's going to be too late to get saved. If God is dealing with your heart tonight, we want you to make a move for God tonight while the door of mercy is open. You say, how do you know the door of mercy is open? Because if God is dealing with your heart while we're preaching, he wouldn't play games with you. If God is dealing with your heart, it's because the door of mercy is still open and he wants you to come back home. Come on and read it. And he cried and said,
Father Abraham,
Father Abraham,
have mercy upon me.
And send Lazarus. Come on.
That he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue.
Come on.
For I am tormented in this place.
He couldn't get a dip. Just that. That's all I ask for. Just that. God, please, you got oceans, man. There is not mercy to the degree of a drip of water in eternity. You cannot fathom no mercy. In jail, even if you got 10 years, you think one day. You got 20 years, one day. You know, even though you say, but what about those that got life? Don't you know a majority of those that got life, they're thinking that perhaps one day if I get this appeal, or perhaps if they change this law, or perhaps the government, they be writing presidents, dear President Obama, I'm on death row. I'm scheduled to die January 1st, 2016. If you can find it in your heart to pardon me that day that you leave office, I'll be forever grateful. And they're holding on to that. Just holding. Hey, listen, Sam, I'm going to let you know how important mercy is to our psyche. Even though they're on their way to the gas chamber, don't you know to that last hour they're sitting there hoping that that walk down the hall is going to come. That the warden going to walk in there and say, the ACLU or whoever appeal did go through, you're coming out. But in hell, you're going to realize there's absolutely no mercy. No mercy. There's nothing you can do to change your status. Free tonight for mercy's sake. If you're not right with God, we want to invite you to an altar of prayer. We want to invite you just in your heart, say, God, forgive me today. I'm sorry for the sins I've committed. Save me, Lord. Change my heart. I want to be saved. If you save me tonight, God, and you would help me, I promise you I'll live for you for the rest of my life. I've tried it my way. I've done things my way. And Lord, I want to try it your way from this day forward. It doesn't take money. All it takes is a sincere heart and a sincere prayer. If you want to pray, you can come on up. Come on and read.
And he cried and said, Father Abraham,
yes,
have mercy on me.
Come on.
And send Lazarus, that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue. For I am tormented in this place.
Oh, there's flames in hell. Come on and read.
And Abraham said, come on. Remember that thou in thy lifetime receivest thy good things.
My Lord, in hell you have a memory. You have a memory, and you remember all the things in life. He said, thy good, thy. He didn't say good things. He said, thy good things. The things in life you thought was good. You thought, like Brother Frank was saying earlier, I'm going to go out. I'm going to go in the world. I ain't going to go too far. I'm going to, your good things. The things that caused you to not get saved is going to be the things that God said. Remember? He going to bring that. Remember him? You ain't going to see his face. He sent you to hell. You remember her? You remember you thought that you was going to be that rap star? You was going to be that number one rap star. Remember you thought you was going to be that next Beyonce? That's why you didn't get saved? Because the devil pulled that one? It's different tricks the devil got. Sometimes he'll pull this one. Let me pull my superstar trick. Boom. Is he going to get it? Is he going to bite? I hope he bite. Remember you thought you was going to be that super athlete that everybody's going to wear your shoes and you're going to sign that contract. Multi-million. Yeah, look at me. Oh, let me get that. Come on. Let me get that trick. Let me get thy good things. You're going to remember.
My Lord.
In that great day.
Come on, Brother Lee.
In hell. Say for a moment. Roll back the curtain.
Lord.
Think about your good things. The things the devil tried to get you with. The things the devil tried to get you to go to hell for. If God hadn't woke you up, that one day God woke us up. One day God shook us. One day God rose and opened our eyes and let us see the fallacies of this world. And Saints, if you had that happen, that took a miracle. That took a miracle for you to see the truth. Come on and read.
But Abraham said,
yes.
Remember that thou in thy lifetime receivest thy good things, and likewise Lazarus evil things.
Yes.
But now he is comforted.
Now he's going forth. Come on, read.
And thou art tormented.
Oh my God, read.
And besides all this,
yes.
Between us and you, there is a great gulf.
Despite besides the burning, despite this, besides the fact you're going to see those that maybe you didn't, besides all of that, there's a great gulf fixed. A great span fixed so that they would pass from hence to hell to heaven. Cannot, neither can they pass to us that would come to this. Oh my Lord. He says, not only will I not have mercy, but I'm going to put a great gulf fixed so no mothers, if they wanted to go be their children. You may say, my mom, she's going to get me out of hell. On that great day, mama can't get you out of hell, bro. My granddad, he gonna get me out of hell. Your granddad can't get you out of hell. There's a great gulf fixed. But you know what's beautiful tonight? That great gulf that's between sin, hell, and heaven. That great gulf that's between sin and salvation. One day, a man from Galilee named Jesus hung on a cross so he could span that great gulf. And all you gotta do is come to the cross. All you gotta do is come to the feet of Jesus. And that great gulf, that great span, you can make it over from sin to salvation. That great gulf. That great gulf tonight. Tonight, no matter what you got bound by, no matter what is keeping you from God, Jesus said, come on, come on, come on, come on, come on, and don't get up, my God, come on, come on, and I'll make a span between that great gulf in you, so you will be on your way to heaven. Come on, Henry.
Then he said, I pray thee therefore, Father,
yes.
That thou wouldest send him to my father's house, for I have five brethren, that he may testify unto them.
He said, pray unto thee. Hell is a place that prayer no longer works. You can pray all you want. So many people are not tonight praying hell. They probably having a prayer with every saint of God child that's ever been in hell. They probably having a prayer meeting like you wouldn't believe. You couldn't hear them go to prayer meeting up here. They crying, I don't go to prayer meeting. I'm telling you, my mom said she was trying to make you go. I don't want to go to prayer meeting as soon as I get over. I'm tired of going to prayer. But in hell, they praying up a storm. Oh, they calling, they quoting scriptures. They put it in God. God is the Father, you have mercy. You delight in mercy. Father, you a good God. Oh, they singing songs, my God. In the light of God. Oh, they going.
Work no more. My
prayer. Does not work in hell.
My Lord.
Praying tonight, while prayer does work, let's pray. Tonight, while prayer does work and God is on the other end, hope God is sitting there. Please call me. Please call me tonight. Just call me. Come on, read. We're almost done. Come on, read.
And he said, I pray thee therefore, Father.
You ever had somebody, you was courting or before you got married, or what? You hoping that they call you. You ever had you just hoping that they, that one person you hope, man, I would like for her to call me. I hope he calls me. I hope he, that's how God is with you right now tonight, Sam. Man, can you imagine God of all creation? Come on, please, I hope he called me. I hope he called me tonight. I hope he called me. Please, I hope he called me. Just call me. Just tell me you're sorry. Just tell me you're ready to join my team. Just tell me you're ready. Just tag me tonight. But what about the devil? He got me bound. Just tag me and turn me loose on the devil. The stuff you bound by. Tag me tonight. Just tag me and turn me loose. I don't care what you bound by. Just tag me tonight. Turn me loose on cigarettes. Turn me loose on weed. Turn me loose on drinking. Turn me loose on lusting. Turn me loose on lying. Just turn me loose tonight. You ain't got to deal with the devil. Just come up and tag me tonight. Come on, Marie. Yes.
Come on. I have five brethren.
Come on.
That they may testify unto them.
streets of Jackson. I want them to get right. Send them to Jackson. Send them down there. Come on, hurry.
Lest they also come into this place of torment.
Yes.
Abraham said unto him, they have Moses and the prophets. Let them hear them.
Come on.
And he said, nay, Father Abraham. But if one went unto them from
the... He said they have Moses and the prophets tonight. That represents God's word. He said, I can't go to your father. I can't send Lazarus. I can't. They got the word of God. If my word mixed with my spirit does not convict them and cause them to come and say, Jesus Christ, come into my heart, he says nothing else will. Come on and read as we close.
And he said, nay, Father Abraham, but if one went unto them from the dead,
one went from the dead,
they will be dead.
Yes.
And he said unto him, if they hear not Moses and the prophets,
if they hear not God's word, the preaching of God's word, the tender, loving God and his word, they will not, come on and read.
Neither will they be persuaded.
Neither will they be persuaded.
Though one rose from the dead.
Though one came from the dead. If somebody came from hell tonight, on fire and said, please give your life to God. Please don't come here. He said, if they don't hear my loving word compelling them to come and give their heart to God, please get saved before it's too late. He said, they will not hear though one rose from the dead. Jesus preached a message, Lazarus and the rich man, to help people avoid going to a place called hell. Tonight, the word was re-preached. May God bless you. Shall we stand? If there's anybody tonight that want to be saved, you come on up. We'll pray with you right now. Anybody tonight want to make a move for God? Anybody tonight saying, I just want to be right with God, man. I want to be right. I'm not talking about this, that, and the other, but I want to be right with God. I want to be right. You come right on. That's right. Is there one more? Let's come on up. Let them come on up. We're going to pray with everybody tonight. We're just going to have prayer tonight, saints. Just sit right over here. We're just going to have prayer. Come on up. Anybody else? We all going to just pray tonight. We're going to pray tonight. Sit right here. Yeah. We're going to have prayer. Let them sit right here. You just sit. Yeah, sit right here. Music get going. Anybody else tonight? We're going to just pray tonight. We want to be right. Well, you guys are mad. This is just about getting right with God. This is about getting right with God. Learn it. Check us out. This is about getting right with God. Anybody else tonight? Anybody else just want to get right with God? This is a preacher. I want to get right with God. I don't want to die and wish I got right. I don't want to leave here and wish I got some things right in my life. But tonight, I just want to be right with God as a singer saved as anybody else. Let's get all the way right tonight.
did not perish, but have everlasting life. Yes, the message of Jesus Christ. I'm tired. Anybody tired tonight? I'm tired of sin and strain, Lord. I'm tired. I'm just tired. I wake up and go to bed, same thing week after week. I'm tired.
Looking for a certain deliverance. Something you may be bound by. Something you may be
I make perfect. The Bible said that man upon Mount Zion shall be deliverance. Because holiness is preached there. Free from sin, that's what holiness is. You don't commit sin after you get saved. You don't have to. You don't want to. And God can keep you from doing it. Is it a one more?
Go tonight. I'm done with it. can still save your souls from this horrible, horrible life of sin. God is yet saving souls. He's not going to let the devil just work. He's got to work for it. Amen. Thank God. Out of my head, because we're sent about and grace much more about. We may say the devil is busy, but God is busier. Thank God. Amen. We serve an on-time God. We serve an understanding God. We serve a compassionate God. Thank God, Sister Victoria, tonight. Amen, amen. Let's turn it around tonight. 60 years. My God. It's a sad thing to look back to life and say, I wasted many years. I wasted hearing and saying, I could have been saved. I could have been a better example for my children. I could have been a better example for my sons, my daughters. But I wasted years. I thought I had it going on, but I didn't have nothing going on. I wasted years. God will help you redeem the time. Friend, let's go redeem the time tonight. Let's come and redeem the time tonight. Oh, how foolish. I wish I wouldn't have done it. I wish I would have gotten right. I wish I would have stopped. I wish I would have. Turn around. God is calling you, friend. You. God is calling you, friend. You. From a life of wasted years. Wasted years.
Oh God, oh God.